well, thank you everybody for being here, and thank you to the Energy Institute and Neil for inviting me. I see, a lot of colleagues that I'm working on right now here, so this is a great opportunity to get feedback on some of these groundbreaking research, although, I think, Neil, you set expectations too high. So this is what I want to talk to you today. I'll just give you a little bit of background on what I'm working on more broadly. I'll tell you about why I decided to focus my talk on energy innovation and the role of government. So what's the motivation and what is the context for this question, or research area rather. And then I'll talk about three areas of research that to me are very important in helping governments and other decision makers accelerate a transition to a more sustainable, more secure energy system. So I'd like to say here that I don't think these are the three only key research questions that are important. Many of you will be working on energy in other, trying to ask slightly different questions, looking at different actors, looking at different parts of the system. These are just the ones that I personally have found interesting and that I'm working on actively. So the first one is looking at uncertainty and volatility in energy policy. The third one is looking at a system level experience and some of that we have seen in developing countries. So I started my work in this area in energy back in 2007, and most of my early work was focused on the US. More recently, I've done more work on China, India, and other countries, and I think that this is an area that, where there's a lot to learn on. And the third kind of main point that I wanted to talk to you today in terms of new developments is on the what we are starting to learn about the impact of policies at a firm level. I'll conclude with some key takeaways, and then I'll tell you a little bit about future research. Some of the things I'll mention in future research are things that I'm working on or that I think somebody should work on. And because it's already 5:30 p.m., I wanted to start with one of my last slides on key messages. The first one, which you could have guessed from the title of one of the three research sections that I mentioned, is that we are still not at the point in which policymakers' policy design is including or accounting for uncertainty, both in technological change but in other areas. And one thing I'll say is that we need to more systematically account for uncertainty, not just in terms of technological change or in the design of policies, but also in the implementation of policies. So this is coming a little bit more to the area of managing expectations and the political process, but I think this is an area where there's a lot that we could do to help get better policies in place and help them be more long-lasting. The second point is about the fact that we have a new set of evidence from emerging and countries. We're seeing a trade-off in approaches, different policies that some of these developing countries put in place, may have different impacts in terms of the speed of what they achieve, the risks that they address, the performance of the technologies, and the actors that get involved, so the type of financing. So I think that some of the lessons or experiences that we're seeing from the early mover developing countries can be helpful for the third mover developing countries in some of the new energy technologies. And of course, we have differences by technology. Third, and this is something that I was very surprised by when I started working in energy policy again in 2007-2008, there was very little evidence about the impact of government programs in energy in terms of how these programs affected performance at the firm level. And we are starting to see much more of this. So I'll talk to you about some new work, mainly from 2015-2016 in this area. So I think it's an area where we're starting to get more evidence. And finally, my last point is that, and Neil is not going to like this because I keep expanding, but here, what I wanted to mention is that there are opportunities for learning from experiences, not just within the energy sector or different countries in energy sector, but also from other sectors, from health, agriculture, manufacturing. So there's some of the work that I've done suggests that there's more that we can do to learn from experiments that have happened elsewhere. I'm going to skip the background since I have 5 minutes less than I thought I would. And I wanted to start with the motivation. You all probably know this to some extent because otherwise you wouldn't be here. This is just to give you a sense of how I think about energy and innovation. So we know, of course, that energy is one of the top global challenges, and most studies agree that we need new or improved energy technologies. As based on the number of emails and calls that I'm getting, there's even a greater urgency by policymakers, NGOs, think tanks, and so forth, to think about how to accelerate innovation in the wake of two relatively recent events. The first one was the September approval of the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, one of which is about innovation, and every other one actually needs innovation to be achieved. And then the second is, of course, the Paris Agreement. And in fact, you may know that 28 billionaires with Bill Gates have formed a coalition to fund energy innovation. There was a mission, you know, an agreement between the President of France, the President of India. So there's a lot of, a growing sense of urgency that maybe there's more that we can do in innovation. We need innovation. It's a very broad topic. The question that interests me and that interests many people is what governments can do. And of course, this is a very complicated question for four key reasons. The first one is that energy, as I mentioned in the previous slides, is something that where one often has multiple policy goals, so security, climate, environment, access, affordability. You also have a process that is very complex. There are often many policies that can play a role in innovation. And then, of course, we have multiple technologies going from, you know, cars to storage to nuclear power plants. So this is what I think makes this a very interesting but different, difficult area. And this graph, I'm not going to spend too much time. I could spend 20 minutes explaining to you this graph. You can find it in this paper. But the key point that I want to make here is to give you a sense of what I mean when I say innovation. Some people talk about innovation, and they're referring to just research and development, for example. When I talk about innovation, I'm talking about the full thing from R&D to a technology being widely diffused in the market and, you know, retired. So here, you know, for example, on the top, you have adaptation. Here you have adoption, invention. So again, if you want to look at this, it's available, but it's just to give a sense that this is a complex process. And just again, before going to the research, I also wanted to mention that there's a vast literature on the various reasons why governments need to play some role in this area. The first one being the knowledge spillovers, which are common to all R&D, so firms can't appropriate the benefits fully from investing in innovation. Environmental externalities, this is Beijing, we're all very familiar with air pollution problems. Institutional lock-in, so in many cases we have regulations, we have actors that are defending the status quo, where maybe in some cases there may be benefits from trying to open up the playing field to others. And then of course in the energy sector we have, again, in some parts of the energy sector you have long lifetimes, very bulky, lumpy investments, and other things like network effects that make things challenging. On the many policies point, and I guess by now you realize that what I'm doing is to go through those various points of why it's a complex process. There are many policies that can shape innovation or affect innovation, and here we have this typology of technology push policies versus market pull policies. You know, we have on the left-hand side R&D, education. On the right-hand side, we have standards, price incentives. I'm sorry about this. And market-based policies. There are, of course, many others. But the key point is that almost any policy you can think of could have some impact on the pace and direction of where technology will go. Something that many of you will be familiar with is this idea that over time costs go down. This is of course not something with cumulative production. So here you have another logarithmic scale costs in the vertical axis and cumulative production in the horizontal axis. We see transistors being a very common case. In some cases, cost go up, and this is the case of nuclear. people, a colleague of mine at the campus who talks about the forgetting curve for nuclear. And then in some cases, you have costs that go up and then go down. Now, there are a lot of things happening, partly as suggested by the diagram that I showed earlier with all of the arrows of the innovation process. There are a lot of things happening here. We have learning by doing, learning by searching on R&D, spillovers from other sectors, economies of scale, of scope, materials cost. So all of these things are underlying those learning curves. Again, when we think about what is the impact of a policy on a technology, there may be a lot of things happening simultaneously. So this is kind of the context of the various factors that that make energy innovation an interesting area for and a difficult area for governments. I'll start talking now about some of the early research I did on incorporating uncertainty in energy policy decisions, in particular energy research and development decisions. And I'll talk a little bit about institutional volatility too. And I know there's some work here by Neil and others, so I thought that this, you know, it would be a good idea to start with this example since I know that there's some great work on this area too. So I'll start with this example of the United States. Right now, this graph shows governments are in investments in energy over time. The different colors represent the different technology areas. You see, obviously, that in the wake of the oil crisis, there were a lot of investments. Now they're starting to go up again. The interesting thing, or at least me, back in the day when I started doing this, is how decisions are made between solar and wind and nuclear and vehicles and so forth. So when you look at the process, what happens is that, of course, there's a very political process, but even from the beginning, there isn't a systems-level view of how different technologies may be complements, like storage and solar, or substitutes in some cases, like carbon capture, storage, and nuclear, again, in some cases, for example. And they're not, usually in this process, uncertainty is not considered. So it's these market interactions and uncertainty. Partly as a result of that, although not only politics obviously is a big thing, this graph shows the year-to-year percentage change in budget allocations to different programs. The scale here is minus 100%, 300%, so very, you know, really big fluctuations. So this is some sense of this volatility in R&D investments for different areas, partly as a result of this lack of holistic view and long-term view, which is common not just to the US, but to almost every government. Here, what I show is some of the new institutions that were created in the United Kingdom, the US, and China between 2010 in the area of energy. And some of, you know, I'm sure many of you are familiar, the Carbon Trust, the UK Energy Research Center, Energy Technologies Institute. In the US, there were several other ones. There's been a lot of things since then. So this confirms the point that we are at a time in which this is a growing concern, right? What can governments do to accelerate innovation? And there's been a lot of experimentation as well. In the UK, there's been now the catapults, the carbon trust has been had, and things like this. In this paper, in research policy, I argue that in some countries, there's more experimentation and change than in others. I would argue that in the UK, there's more experimentation than in others, for example. I think one crucial point here is how much experimentation one should have and how much one should learn from experience before telling things. But I think, and maybe I'll leave this for the discussion, I found very interesting the, I guess, cultural, in some sense, approaches to institutional change in the US, China, and the UK. And I guess this graph here, only one has to show me 10, I have others, where you see they're basically increasing, and China is now actually also done many things beyond these incentives for state-owned enterprises. Now they're reforming their whole national lab system, and they're reforming their key universities. So now they're taking, I was in June in China, so they're really taken to not just increasing investments which they were doing, but they're also institutionally reforming what they're doing. So how can we policy researchers that aim to be policy relevant help? Well, there's been some work again that I've done with colleagues at the Kennedy School. There's a book that came out in 2014 and then some other work. And what we've seen is that when you include some of these considerations of uncertainty or technological change, you end up getting results that may not come out in other ways. I guess the first one here is not new in the sense that we know from a lot of work that other people have done that R&D, research and development, is not enough to cut emissions. The thing that I found useful in our work is that even when you look at the most optimistic assumptions about future cost of technologies, you know, from experts and all of this, even when you're super optimistic, you're not getting anywhere near where you want to go. So what this shows, and this is not zero, this is 5,400 tons per year. Blue is under a kind of relatively low research and development budget for 25 energy technologies. Red is a very, you know, 10 times bigger research and development budget. No, five, so it's five times bigger, sorry. Then you see that, yes, you bend the curve a little bit, so you go from red, which is the business as usual budget, to blue, which is the higher budget, but you are nowhere near the, you know, the 30%, the 80% cuts that you should have by 2050 if the goals that the Obama administration had set back in 2009 were going to be met. So even when you're very optimistic, and this shows the uncertainty range, it goes actually back to the fifth percentile. So even when you're on the fifth percentile of the technology cost with a very high budget, you're nowhere near where you want to be, as stated in policy. The other thing that we found looking at this uncertainty, and again, this is something that is also available online, so I won't, it's a very complicated graph, but the key point here is this curve and the red numbers here. This is total budget in R&D. And this curve tells you the return on investment measured, you know, the return here is the increase in consumer and producer surplus. You can see the number here for the current investment is 138, 53, 32, and so forth. So even when you go to a much greater investment, you're still positive, and this is just looking at one of the benefits. This, of course, doesn't include the opportunity cost. This is a partial equilibrium model, but still, it gives you some sense of the benefit cost ratio. And the most interesting thing is that came out of this work is that, especially storage, but also solar, under the current allocation, is severely underfunded. So, you know, one of the things that we learned from looking at these 25 technologies is that energy storage is significantly underfunded. This approach is something that I've, you know, this result I've presented various times at the U.S. Department of Energy, including one of their quadrennial technology reviews, their four-year big plans, and they have now an office of policy analysis looking at this integrated thing. So this is something that is becoming more and more valued and used. Same thing in China, but in the Energy Research Institute of the National Development Report Commission. So, of course, there's been a lot of people who have been looking at this area. I'll mention a few other things that I found useful. The first one is this work looking at how different, as by Van Bentham et al. In the Energy Journal, where they found that the cost effectiveness of a California subsidy on solar panels became positive depending on learning assumptions. So depending on what you assumed about this uncertainty, or not this uncertainty, around the rate of technical change, the program became went from a positive to a negative net present value. This paper by Greg Nemeth and Erin Baker showed that R&D was important to increase previous competitiveness, and then I'll just mention a paper that is coming out this month, in which we are moving beyond, or we moved beyond the work that I showed earlier, optimizing R&D investments across these 25 energy technologies, using an optimization approach from a Monte Carlo method, so just assuming that you make decisions today based on what you expect will happen in 2030, and you kind of change your decision in between, which is obviously not how reality works. So with this other approach, we were able to break the decision, to break the period between 2010 and 2030, 50, sorry, into four stages, and show that if you can learn over time in solar, with a cap and trade policy, you would do less R&D in the first period, but more in the second period and so forth. So let me just say one thing about this. I think with models, and again, many of you are modelers, so that's why I want to make sure I say this so that you don't kill me in the Q&A. Different models can get you different things. So with the previous model, we were able to look at, you know, these 25 technologies and various uncertainties and, you know, get an optimal answer for various metrics. I showed some results for consumer and producer surplus. We have the same for other metrics. But we couldn't take into account this learning. With this stochastic approach, we had to limit ourselves to just solar photovoltaics. So we could look at when would you would build solar panels versus investing R&D just for one technology area. So so I guess the key point here is that when you go to this level, which is of course great, you can take into account learning, you're missing out on some of the other pieces. So I think this is an area where when we do research, we need to think about where we want to contribute. And to conclude this point about uncertainty, in the various pieces that I mentioned, actually some of them are also the work by Greg Nemet, a key question is, well, what is this uncertainty? How can we, you know, what are these parameters? And me and a bunch of other people have done these things called expert elicitations, which are just surveys of experts. There's this paper in environmental science and technology and nuclear power, and actually a report in the from the OECD Green Growth Knowledge Platform that just came out with Valentina Bossetti and others, where we review all of the expert elicitations that have been done, which essentially what they do is get a sense from scientific experts of where we are in the cost and performance of technologies and where we're likely to be or where they think we're likely to be. This is one method to think about uncertainty, and in almost any of these decisions, and I've taught policy analysis, you need to have some sense of this. So for anyone, or at least you might be working in this area on the energy policy technology interface, I think we need to do more work on this interface between scientists, analysts, policymakers. This is one of the ways of doing it, but you know, you can do group workshops, you can do, you know, interactive online tools, and this very, in this paper, we actually review what we know and what we don't know about how to do this. So I just, you know, the department I am at, in the Department of Science, Technology, Engineering, and Public Policy, you know, this is one of the things that is, you know, focusing on looking at this interface and how to make it most productive. So let me go to the system level experiences in developing countries, and I keep changing this title. I wanted to differentiate between the system level experiences, which really look at the institutional landscape, the various actors and so forth, and the next section four, looking at the firm level. So this is the more macro view of these energy transitions and the, or energy, I'll keep it at energy transitions, so I'm going to get into all of that. So why have I, did I start studying energy innovation in developing countries? Of course, they have a major role in climate and energy arenas. They're now investing in energy R&D, you know, as a whole, at a level that is comparable with that of all OECD countries combined. As you know, you can read this paper by Markard and Raven and Crocker. They talk about how previous research looking at these macro level transitions has focused mainly on industrialized countries, mainly on European countries. Third, you know, we are starting to have some experience from these early mover developing countries in wind and solar and so forth. So this experience is something that could be helpful to other countries interested in this area. And then, of course, some of the challenges and contexts are different. You know, not everything that we learned from some of the work in developing countries, developed countries, can be applied elsewhere. We have 2.7 billion people relying on traditional biomass, 1.3 billion people who have electricity. And again, different players, and here I will highlight state-owned enterprises to really play a larger role in some of these countries. I will say a few things about China, and let me just tell you a couple of things of why I've done quite a bit on China. First is here, as in terms of R&D as a percentage of GDP, China has now caught up with the EU. And that kind of increase in iron intensity has also translated into a huge increase in the percentage of world peer review publications. Here it goes from, like 1% in 1897 to 13% in 2013. So this is a major player, at least in numbers. Of course, this is not adjusted for quality, but one cannot deny there's much more going on as, you know, as a fraction of the world's total. And of course, most of the, if you look at the investments, these ones are kind of projected by the International Energy Agency. These are deployment investments in renewables in particular, even though right now mostly it's blue and green, the US and the EU. Over time, the developing countries are of course going to play the largest role, so there's a lot to learn. So I started working on this back in 2011 or so, and looking at the evolution of wind price in China. And controlling for a range of things, what we found is that the price of wind had of wind power had decreased at a rate that was slower than that we had seen in other countries, in industrialized countries. We also found that there were a lot of policies that were domestic that were playing an important role in the price of electricity that various wind farms were able to ask for, with farm sizes, steel prices, wind quality, various policies. And what we found is that this slower rate and the fact that various policies have an impact on the price has implications for models that actually look at the evolution of prices over time. But it also, whenever I talk about this research, people ask me about, well, what about curtailment and what about other challenges in China? And I was like, well, I can tell you about some of the policies, but I really didn't have this type of systemic view. So then I started doing more work in this area to try to explain this. Here we have average capacity factors. I assume people, this is basically what fraction of the time your wind turbine is working. When you look at China, the capacity factor is much, half of that in the US, and significantly smaller than that in the EU. So yes, there are a lot of things going on in China, I guess, and we'd like to understand what is driving this big difference in capacity factors. The interesting thing about this is that even though the actual capacity factor is 15, most of the projections by various agencies are very different. They go to the 25 or 30%. What we found during this research is that there are various factors that are policy driven that are causing this difference between what one could achieve in other countries or under a different set of incentives and what one can achieve in China. This is perhaps to be expected given that the reason why China grew their wind power manufacturing and deployment was most likely not to produce a lot of wind power, it was more related to building an industry, but still their argument is that without a different set of incentives, these capacity factors are hard to achieve. So there are various factors that can contribute to different capacity factors, what turbines you use, what sites you choose, grid connection, which has been the focus of most of the debate, and the curtailment of grid-connected power, so you produce power, but it doesn't get used because the grid doesn't really let you do that. And this is a graph that basically shows where we quantify at a wind farm level, what are the causes of this difference in potential. And what you see, we have project design factors, the siting and turbine choice, operational factors, and one-off factors. So, you weren't connected for a while, I won't explain this. So the key point here is that the factors that stay there for the duration of the wind farm that are locked in account for a huge fraction of the loss in capacity factor. Let me say that this is not implying that wind farms should all, go to this 53%. But it just tells you that the gaps are, much bigger in that area than in other areas where the focus has been. The key point is that when you compare these gaps between the technical potential and the actual generated power with the US, China lags in all spaces, which suggests that the different that the incentives that have been set in the U.S. Lead to project developers choosing sites and choosing turbines and you know maintaining their facilities in a way that is different than that in the U.S. So we're starting to see what are some of the contextual reasons that are resulting in this lower capacity factor in China. And of course, this has implications for policies on what wind farm, what sites you promote, what sort of information you require people to have in terms of the quality of the wind, what sorts of competition you introduce between, in terms of what tenders for buying turbines, so that you don't have no market relationship determining what turbines get used. So I've talked about how the way in which wind power in China has followed, has a different price trajectory. They have different policies and different incentives. I thought it would be interesting to see what system of policies was put in place in China versus in India, which has been also another early mover in the sense of a developing country that also in the late 80s, 1980s started promoting the wind sector. So here we have at the end of paper that is in global environmental change. Here you have deployment in terms of gigawatts and percentage of generation in China at the top and in India at the bottom. You have these different phases, and what you clearly see here is that that China had a much more, slower growth at the beginning, but then also more constant. So China, India had much more of a volatile deployment of wind. What you see here is that when you look at all of, we looked at all of the policies that the Chinese government and then the Indian government had put when in China, and categorized them based on resource and technology availability, financing availability, project implementation risk, grid and transmission risk, and various other things, and then over time. And what we saw is that, loosely speaking, over time, both countries followed the same sequence, so they were addressing the same risks. So they started focusing on technology, financing, counterparty, and transmission, which is seems reasonable, right? But there were slight differences in terms of the emphasis. So, for example, in China, in the early phase, they really didn't pay very much attention to grid transmission risk and project implementation. But once the industry was already going, they had a lot of, they were very active in all areas of project development. Compare this with China, what you see is that you see much less activity here, while they were doing a lot more early on to make sure things were connected. So India had a much more laissez-faire approach in the commercialization phase. And this partly their actors in their innovation system and the policies that they use, which to some extent favored the actors that were already strong, did result in very different outcomes. So when you look at manufacturing in China at the top, you have a much greater share of domestic manufacturers when compared to India. You also have project developers that are very different. So in China, you have project developers that own an average of 800 turbines, so big, state-owned enterprises, many of them. In China, in India, you have the average is 60 turbines. So you have a very different size of firms and also very different in terms of public versus private. So here is the percentage of turbines owned by a private entity in China and here in India. So there's much more, it's a much more liberalized market in India. So yes, this is of course something that you might expect, right? When you think about, well, who are the players? Who were the players in India, China in the 1980s? But India also has a lot of state-owned enterprises. So these were really very two very different approaches to develop their wind sector, and they've had trade-offs. So there are three things that we looked at. The first one is the role of the state in financial resource mobilization. There's a trade-off between promoting investment in state-owned enterprises and also the private sector. These were conscious decisions that, of course, partly depend on the entrenched sectors, but partly could be changed at the margin. The timing between free ride, between moving early or I'm trying to become a first mover, or then ramping up very quickly. And then, what resources you bring. Do you bring domestic versus foreign resources? And I'll mention quickly a comparison. I talked earlier about, the fact that different technologies may be different, right? And here, one interesting comparison that I worked on is looking at wind in China and solar in China. So the story that I talked to you about earlier is that in the mid-80s, China started, putting in place all kinds of policies, mainly to help state-owned enterprises and domestic manufacturers. In solar PV, we've seen that that China PV manufacturing was pretty low in the 2000s. Within 5 years, 6 years, they started getting a huge share of the world PV manufacturing capacity. Was the story the same as in wind? Was this a state-driven support for both R&D, manufacturing plants, building wind farms? And what we see, and this was, most of the other things I talked about were modeling and things like this. This was more an interview-based study doing fieldwork. And what we found is that when you look at these five key resources, one is the domestic absorptive capacity, which is very familiar to those of you who work in the development arena. And here we talk about what it is. Obviously, these were some of the things where China was strong: trade infrastructure, generic mass manufacturing capabilities. That was obviously domestic, but all of the other things, where did the knowledge come from to build the manufacturing plants? Where did they get the, where were they selling? Where did they get the financing? Where did they get legitimacy to give people confidence in their panels? What we see is that most of those things were international in the period between 2000 and 2008. So in that period, the Chinese central government was not doing anything to subsidize the industry. So this just shows you where, Goldman Sachs was viewing financing from the US. So it was transnational entrepreneurs that mobilized this. So I will just say that what we found was that the development of the solar PV industry in China did not come from renting out previous industries. So those of you who may know about, their relatedness theories, how do industries emerge by renting out related ones, right? So we're seeing that that wasn't the case. In China, also, there wasn't a targeted policy intervention. And so there's this very fast catching up process that has implications for both developing countries thinking about building industries, or from industrialized countries thinking about trying to, lead manufacturing in a particular area. So it's this idea of what types of industries and what types of countries can actually do this, right? So that's a question I'll come back to at the end. And since I should be finishing soon, I will just tell you on this point that we can learn a lot from experiences in other countries, and this is also available on my Kennedy School website. So it's a project looking at water, energy, health, manufacture, and energy. We did 18 case studies, a big review, and we talk about some of the things that you can learn from. And then I'll conclude with giving you a sense of some of the information that is starting to become available regarding the impact of various policies at a firm level. You may be familiar with a lot of the growing emphasis on randomized controlled trials and various development interventions and energy efficiency. And I know that there's work here too. I'll just give two examples. So in this website, you can find some of the studies that have been done to see what to what extent does weatherization of houses result in a positive cost benefits analysis, or if you give information to people, do they reduce their energy, that sort of thing. So we're starting to get much more information on this. But there are other areas where this is harder, this may be harder to do. There's work that has been done looking at whether the clean development mechanism has resulted in the, in additionality. So if projects that got funding from the clean development mechanism wouldn't have happened otherwise. And this was my PhD student on day 10, which showed that there was no difference in the internal rate of return of projects funded by the CDM and not funded by the CDM. But I'll just mention this. So there's a paper that is in coming out soon looking at whether firms in the US that receive funding from the small business, you know, funding source at the Department of Energy, how well they did, right? And, you know, these things were not available before. So this study showed that, yes, you know, on award levels, the probability that firms receive subsequent venture capital funding. Gabe Chan also has a paper that shows, well, if you're a national lab and you actually license a patent, that patent then results in more spillover benefits in other areas. And work that I'm finishing right now also shows that US government grants clean tech startups actually, you know, alliances both in terms of knowledge transfer and other types of partnership actually are associated with improvements in patents and growth and IPOs in these firms. And we also see a strong impact of licensing. So we're starting to see that this theory that governments can, you know, address some of these market failures, you know, how that, you know, have an impact. And in fact, one thing that we saw that was very interesting is that whether or not these government grants were associated with positive impacts on startups, depending on whether or not your startup was already part of. We did this big network analysis on all of the startups and the different partners in financing, government, NGOs, other firms, and we saw that those that were more, you know, unconnected, that were part of the loose group, were the ones that benefited the most. So we're starting to learn a little bit about where are government efforts and dollars and so forth most useful. And I wanted to show you some the reason why all of this is starting to become available only now is that until recently, governments did not want to give this data. So I was going to show you a slide with some of these results that I have from China just today. As I was coming on the train, they said no. You know, we'll have to rethink about this. So, you know, this is, there are, and of course, you know, I can see, one can see why, but I think we're starting to get more information from these macro level experiences in developing countries, and also from these more micro level analysis, which of course have the huge problem of external validity. How can you extrapolate from this study of the small businesses by the Department of Energy in the US to a different, you know, even in the UK, same similar group, you know? So this is a this question of transferability of some of these emerging results is one that I think needs more work. Oh, so that's one I need to skip. So I talked about the key messages already, the uncertainty, the more information from developing countries, trade-offs, differences by technology. We have more information on evaluating programs and opportunities to learn from experiences in health, for example, in agriculture, which actually have a lot of examples of kind of, you know, successful interventions, particularly in the development arena. In terms of future research, some of them you might not find surprising. So the first one is this question of the effectiveness of different innovation incentives. So we talked about some of these randomized controlled trial work, mainly on adoption. But one question that I think is very interesting that has not been done is looking at how do different types of early stage innovation mechanisms, prices, grants, procurement, investments in human capacity, what are the types of innovation or activities or players or outcomes that they impact? What are the complementarities between policy instruments? So between, you know, this idea of, you know, having a standard and an R&D policy, and what are the differences by technology? The second big area is, that I mentioned earlier, is for what types of industries and contexts is industry transplantation possible? And again, this is important when one, you know, I'm from Spain, and of course Spain had huge subsidies for solar panels with the argument that they would create jobs in Spain, but of course they just imported panels from China. So I think this, you know, question of international industry mobility is important. Transferability of experiences from different technologies and contexts, how can we think about this? In this working paper that I mentioned, we talk about this idea of socio-technical characteristics to at least have some sort of heuristic that helps you think about what you can take, or you know, what things you should look out for. And third and fourth, and I did not talk about this because you know I don't work on everything. But and I know actually that Michael Grubb is doing some stuff in this area. I've talked to him about this. Given all the you know, given that everybody agrees in this idea that we need more in more R&D, you know, there's usually things earlier stage in the innovation process is easier to get some sort of agreement about. But how can you actually manage this? So there's, you know, how can you engage users? How can you get agreement with various partners? How do you work with the private sector? So I think this idea, governance of international collaboration and energy R&D, I think is a very interesting question also. And I'll conclude by thanking my co-authors here who are in various places, and thank you all for your attention. I know it's been fast, so hopefully this is great. Thank you.
Laura, thank you so much. That was a real tour de force, and I'm sure we have many questions. We'll now move on to a question and answer session. The perfect question and answer session, our short focused questions and short focused answers. So let's aim for that lofty goal. As we're a mixed group, please could you tell us who you are when you ask your question. So please, from the audience, who has a question for Laura? Otherwise, I'm going to ask her 20 questions myself. Do you like that? Yes, please, sir.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand well about the technical because the situation was context is very complicated, and I guess you explained the everything in a complicated manner. So my question is the final part. How do we need to govern the research and development internationally globally? And as you know, the UK, the US, the UK is proposing the global approach to the war, to the global war, and particularly for the COP21. So how do you think that the proposal, how the COP21 result is going to change?
So the question is, how should they design this global R&D efforts, or how do I think that current efforts are going to change?
Well, the how do you think the best manner to the address the future strategy for global collaboration?
That's the one thing I'm actually not working on, but I will say something. So I was asked by a group that is advising Bill Gates and that group on how to allocate funds. So they have these 28 billionaires who are giving money and they're thinking about, well, the first question that they came up with was, how should we allocate it between power generation, efficiency, transmissions, you know, storage, you know, also agriculture and that sort of thing. So what they did is something like an expert solicitation. So this is available online. If you go to nearzero.org, you know, you see what everybody has said, or you know, the people they consulted. So they started thinking about this question of how to allocate across different areas. The question of the governance structure, you know, how they involve users from, you know, rural areas, or you know, I don't think, or again, I don't know what they're doing. I mean, clearly, if you go to that paper that I mentioned, I'll be happy to send you the link if you email me. Talks about some of the things you should think about to make sure that the technologies that get developed are as accessible and appropriate as possible. So we talk about these social technical characteristics that you need to think about at the minimum, which don't guarantee that you're going to get an answer. So I haven't actually done work specifically on the governance structure, but I have that paper that talks about some of the things you should think about. So I think the research that I talked about at the beginning on R&D allocation could be helpful for thinking about how much emphasis on different areas, but how to then actually make decisions at a project level, I think that needs to look at these social technical characteristics, but I haven't really, you know, done too much work on that area.
Other questions? Let's take Paul first.
Okay, I'm Paul Bowe, director of UCL Energy Institute, and my question is short. Have you tried to apply your techniques analysis techniques to demand-side technologies, for example, insulation, changes in heating systems and so on?
Yes and no. So in that set of 25 technologies that I mentioned for the big optimization analysis, so the stochastic one, no, we just did solar. We included five different types of vehicles. So we have, you know, plug-in hybrids, hybrids, more advanced internal combustion engines, and hydrogen. And initially, we had an expert felicitation on buildings, efficiency in buildings, right? And we ended up not being able to do that. That was too complex, you know, we just couldn't fit it in the, I can tell you later in the drinks if you want what products we had. So we only did vehicles, we didn't do installation in buildings. And the reason for this is that even after talking to tons of architects and, you know, people at MIT, they're, you know, in all of these places, you know, the questions that we ended up asking were, for a retrofit or for a new building, how much more efficient can you get for what cost? So we said, okay, this is a you know, standard, you know, 5,000 feet or whatever building. How much does it cost you to retrofit to 20%, 30%, you know, efficiency? Same thing with a new build. That just, you know, when you know, that was the best we could do. But then that was one, you know, still not very easy to translate into the modeling, and also it was very hard to tie that to the government funds. So I guess on buildings, no, we did not do it.
And I had a subsidiary question, very short one.
Sure.
I mean, might it be useful to apply your analysis of socio-technical characteristics to that problem in different countries?
To the problem of buildings?
Buildings.
Yeah, I mean, right. Yes, I mean, right now, when we, and one example that I'm with Sagar, who is in the IIT Delhi, who was at the Kennedy School for many years, so he, you know, he said, you know, nobody's working, and there's orphan draw, you know, there's a lot of examples, nobody's working on fans that work in Indian houses, you know? So, yes, I think so.
Should we go back out for other questions? Will, please.
Will McDowell, lecturer here at UCL Energy and ISR. So, thanks. I'm interested in the technology prioritization issue and the use of expert solicitation for informing that. In the UK, we had recently a strategic framework on low carbon innovation, which was informed by a whole bunch of innovation needs assessments, which were themselves informed by models, by energy system models, which clearly there are ways that they can be very complementary, expert solicitation of the models, but setting them up slightly as alternative ways of thinking about technology prioritization. Do you see divergence between those kind of model-based approaches and expert solicitation-based approaches to technology prioritization? Or do they tend to end up with similar kinds of priority lists?
I've only looked at that in the US, and I can say that the priority lists that you would get are different in the US. So, because those are more guided by who has more power, which are usually the older programs, and you know, the way they, you know, they were traditionally doing it is, you know, each program says, oh, you know, if you give me this much, this is how good I will be, and then there's like a big fight, and what we saw is that storage and solar will be underfunded no matter what metric you use. I mean, yes. So the one experience I know about, I would say that, you know, they ended up coming out, you know, differently. Of course, and there's just the normal politics, right, which I think were, I mean, I don't know to what extent politics came into that assessment. That was more of a technocratic approach. Yeah, so in theory that should be, yeah, so I think that if you think about this issue of the system and the complementarity and substitutability, if, you know, you can imagine that in some cases, just by looking at things separately, you don't get as good of a sense of where there may be value added when you're, you know, complementing them or, you know.
I've got Paul here. Everyone at the back is being very shy, so we'll stay at the front first. Paul, please.
Hi, thanks, Neil. Paul Egan, UCL Institute for Sustainable Resources. Thanks very much for that, Dora. I'm interested that in your justifications for government getting involved in innovation, you gave a number of good economic reasons in general, but you didn't give sort of national competitiveness and you know, development of new industries and all that kind of stuff. But in my experience, that's what governments think they're going to get out of innovation. Although, as you said yourself, as regards Spain, they thought they were going to get it, and some of that experience in Germany too, they didn't get it. what evidence are you finding when you're looking at these different countries and the innovation that they're pursuing, that there is a justification in terms of competitiveness, lead markets, all that stuff? Because in my experience, that's what policymakers are really interested in.
Well, so in China, in their push for the development of the wind sector, both development, you know, manufacturing, and that was the reason. And I would argue they did work, in the sense that they have a big industry. They're selling, domestically to a large extent, but they're starting to export. India's push, led to a lot of imports and a lot of foreign firms manufacturing there, and one big giant, Suzlon, right? So you can think about, different approaches led to, the creation of industry and some, competitiveness in that sector. So I think I haven't done a cost-benefit analysis of all of those various policies that were dots in the diagram, how they compare to the, exports, of turbines, or lower electricity prices, or, reduce CO2 emissions. So I obviously, when I'm talking about success, I'm not talking about success in the sense of, let's do the cost-benefit analysis of programs and benefits. I'm talking about the fact that those two countries tried to create an industry, and they created an industry that is, at some level, I guess Suzlon is more competitive internationally than the Chinese state-owned enterprises. So I think the Chinese government is certainly happy that they have a domestic industry. But yes, I think the question about the cost-benefit analysis is very hard. They'd like to do it. In fact, we gathered a lot of policies, but then you think it's impossible to estimate the cost of all of those policies. So I think that would be the really cool thing to answer. And I tried, actually, but it's just too hard. There's too many things, provincial level stuff, all of those various policies that even in the US or places where you have access to more data, when you try to see, well, how much does the renewable portfolio standard cost, or how much, the production tax credits and other things cost, it's very hard to do an actual cost-benefit analysis. So yes, I guess I didn't put the infant industry argument, which is of course another economic argument. I should add it in. So that's a good point for my next talk.
Okay, going further back, I can see Peter. So let's do Peter first, and then we'll come back to Nish.
Yeah, Peter Warren from the Farm Energy and Climate Change. There's another question on sort of small businesses. So I think you sort of came across a bit on slide 45. But I'm quite interested to know if you know of any successful government programs around the world that have developed networks of innovation learning or knowledge transfer between SMEs internationally, so groups of SMEs in different countries.
No, I don't know of any specific examples. So there's more work on the impact of some of these grants, on patenting, on sales, new products, and again, even in the case of China, which I sadly can show you, but no. I don't know how much the International Energy Agency is doing through their implementing agreements. I think it's mainly big players, not really SMEs.
So Nish from UCL Energy Institute, you had a slide where you showed the technical potential of grid and capacity utilization and the actual that's realized. You had several different factors in the middle. How did you go about estimating for different sort of categories within that frame and within those categories? And did you think that you may have missed some others because you've got a technical potential and realized how you might be some of the social factors?
Yeah, so social factors can contribute to the different gaps. So we have, we can quantify, how much wind, we know how much wind there is in all of the sites they have. So we have, it is all firm project level data. So, each wind farm in China, what is the wind resource in that area, what turbine they had, at what height, when did it get connected, when did it get connected. So we have all of that data. We have a residual, which accounts for the, micro siting. So within the site, how well you know how to position the turbine and how well you take care of the turbine operations and maintenance. But even the decision of where to site the project, that depends on the policy incentives, and it depends on the social and the cultural context, who is friends with whom, what, person in a provincial government may want to build in a particular place versus another place. So I guess what this is to say is that we have these gaps, which I think are pretty comprehensive, especially given that we have a reciprocal where we have everything else that is not those gaps. But the size of those gaps is driven by policies and is driven by, you know, political factors and by social factors. You know, people not wanting to build in a particular place. So in China, that's less of an issue. Opposition to building.
So just to confirm, that was the average of all.
Yes, that was the average for all of China, but this was aggregated from the bottom up, at the mid-ground level. And you know, the interesting thing would be to do this for India, actually, to see, because we have the comparison US-China, we know that there are very different incentives, but given that we have all this information about the policies and the different actors that were mobilizing India and some of the, you know, different real issues that, you know, that were there, to what extent are those gaps different in India? So, if anybody has data on India,
okay, let's have a last go at questions. I only see one hand. Are there any other hands? So there are two hands. So we'll go to you first, and then we'll give you the last question. Okay.
I have another particular question. You showed us one prostor diagram showing the algorithmic linear function of the number of the PV cell or transistors. And also a alcohol.
In the linear function between?
A four curve of the number of the transistors, number of the PV cells,
uh-huh.
And alcohol.
Yeah, the China graph on wind.
Is some kind of the value or the money, so price.
I mean, the cost reduction.
The cost reduction?
Yeah. My question is the solid state, so the can easily understand the number of the, in case of the transistor or the solar cell.
The learning curve the transistors.
Yeah. Oh, I see.
It was quite early on, I think.
Yeah.
The, but why the other, the chemical function is...
Oh, the first one, yes. This one?
Yeah, the... very, very clear, a linear path for PV cells and transistors, but a limitedly distributed for ethanol and polymer. So, what did you try to conclude from this?
This is a paper by Jessica Transic and others, and they actually talk about that difference, the fact that you have a much more volatile cost in coal plants. You know, versus the more regular cost increases in others. So I can send you that paper if you want to. Why there is that difference?
So you mean the solid state is very, very predictive, but the energy part is not predictive.
This one is a little more regular. But even if it seems very regular, depending on which two points you use, you actually get a very different learning rate, which is one of the reasons why the solar paper that I mentioned on PV in California. This is more regular than this one, right? But this one is more regular than this one and that one, right?
Top two.
This one is energy too. But yes, so even between this one and this one, there is a big difference. Partly is the scale issue. You know, these PV cells and transistors are made in a manufacturing plant with a very standardized process, always kind of at the same scale. This one, you have a lot of, I'm a chemical engineer by training, so when you actually scale up a reactor, you go from, the fluid dynamics change, so it's much harder in some cases to scale up. So you have different issues with, different technologies. And different, here you might have different types of coal, different types of biomass, in PV cells and transistors, you have raw materials that are a little bit more specified. So there are some differences between those two types of technologies.
Sorry to interrupt you, but I think that's probably a follow-up.
I can send you that paper where they've actually talked about that question.
I'm sorry to interrupt you there. We've saved the best question until last.
I hope so. I was going to ask about the difference between push and pull policies. I guess competition between those two, if they're fighting for the same pot of money, the cost effectiveness of the two of them. Any of these, if you've got any comments on, whether one's sort of more cost effective than the other, if you see anything on that. I seem to be perceiving a shift from pull to push in the UK at the moment, and a perception that maybe push is cheaper than pull. I don't know if you think that's true.
I certainly agree with the latter.
One last point on Paul McKinney, whether it's got any relationship on sort of competitiveness of a country. if you were to do it for that, to make our country more effective, make our country more competitive, is pull or push more effective for that?
I think the research that I've done and many other economies have done suggests you need both. The question is, what is the right balance of both, right? The pull policies are much more expensive, you know. But you know, without some sort of market, you know, you won't get the same private sector players involved. And I don't think there's one paper actually that Greg Emmett and Erin Baker wrote where, you know, for a specific case, you know, I think CCS it was, they looked at, you know, for various assumptions of the learning rate, how much deployment you should do versus with some expert solicitation stuff on R&D. I think we know we need both, and if we just have a poll, then the costs are too high. So some of the modeling that we did and a bit other people show, you know, if you just push, you know, put these limits on emissions, then it will be very expensive if you don't do any R&D. I think there's no kind of right percentage of how much pull versus pull, partly because all technologies are different. So you know, if I were to give you a percentage, then you know it may be very different from ethanol than for solar or than for nuclear. So I think it's a great question, one that I wonder myself, but I beyond saying you need both, and that you need to look specifically at the different technologies, I think it's very hard to give an answer to a very good question.
With that, I'll draw this Q&A to a close, please.